called research. This is the start of our second year work. And a bit like with Unit 30 last year, this involves lots of listening to different styles of music and comment on it and showing your musical understanding words to reinforce what you do in class on your guitars and pianos and drums and stuff. So, bar's been risen a little bit. I'm assuming all the stuff that we learnt last year, that's already in your head. So we're looking for slightly more sophisticated analysis of songs as we move into second year and using the language that we learnt last year in a slightly more advanced form. So we start with jazz. I've shared on the document with you a section on jazz, and there's a link to this performance that you'll see in the background on my screen by Fats Waller of a song called Ain't Misbehaving. As you can see, it says it's from 1943, but the song, the performance is, it's from a movie from 1943, but the song was actually written in 1929. So it's right at the beginnings of jazz becoming a commercial force, and Fats Waller's one of those kind of early legends of jazz. He was a great piano player, he was a good singer, but he was also a songwriter. He was the first African-American to compose a Broadway musical as well. So in terms of pushing the boundaries of American society and challenging stereotypes of race in America, he was there writing sophisticated music up there with the likes of Gershwin and Cole Porter, who were white, middle-class, sophisticated, well-educated people. Fats Waller's background was actually in the church. His father was a vicar, I think. Ironically, this song called Ain't Misbehaving was written by Fats Waller when he was in prison. He hadn't done anything too bad. He hadn't paid his ex-wife the money she was owed, so he spent a little bit of time in prison, and he wrote this song when he was in there. So there's an irony of him. He's not misbehaving because he's locked up in prison. That's not what the song's about, though. It's more to do with he's quite happy with his life. He's in love with someone, so he's not going out on the town and getting up to mischief in that way. On a sort of criminal theme, Fats Waller was famous by 1926 as a jazz musician, so much so that when he was playing in Chicago, he got kidnapped by gangsters. He thought he was going to be killed for something that he wasn't aware of what, and they took him undercover in a car, and it turned out to be Al Capone's birthday party, and he had to play for, I think, 48 hours non-stop at this birthday party for Al Capone. He didn't really have a choice, but he earned so much in tips he was able to buy a house in New York with the money that he earned just in tips. I think it was something like $20,000, which was like a massive amount of money. So let's start with our analysis of the performance in the song. Okay, so I'll play it. You won't hear it quite as well as you will if you click on the link on your documents, but I'll play it in the background as we talk and try and point out some stuff. Have a listen. See, as a performer, he likes to kind of ham it up in front of the camera, but we're more interested in the composition of the song. Those changes will sound familiar to you. I'll play them on the guitar quietly in the background here. It's this sort of, and it's you could call it a 1-6-2-5 pattern. We've messed around with songs in the past that do that. It almost sounds like always look on the bright side of life, and it's a standard jazz pattern, the 1-6-2-5. Sometimes it's called rhythm changes, and it's used for jazz musicians to improvise on. Ironically, it's called rhythm changes after a song called I Got Rhythm that came out in 1930. This song was written in 1929, so Fats Waller got there before Gershwin, I think, wrote I Got Rhythm. So we'll hear those kind of standard sort of changes there. Now, this is a form of sweet jazz in that by the time we were getting to the late 20s, early 30s, black musicians were starting to kind of realise that there was this white marketplace with lots more money to be made. And if they just sweetened jazz a little bit from the hot style of New Orleans, it would be more commercial and more appealing to kind of the ear. So you'll notice that the melody, this isn't particularly bluesy, it's quite a diatonic melody. And it's just using the five kind of notes of the major scale, and it's got a classic compositional element in that you've got this kind of little riff, and it's repeated three times, and it goes up the scale. So, no one to walk with, all by myself, no one to talk with, da-da-da-da, 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 sung badly by me. But it's this kind of riff repeated three times melodically, and we'll get a lot of that as we study jazz in a bit more detail, the idea of having a riff sort of played three times with a different variation. And it, generally, you could just talk about it being an ascending diatonic melody. Okay, one that's quite catchy, like a pop song melody. And that's our first verse there, our A section, because this is one of those A-A-B-A songs where you've got eight bars of verse, another eight bars of verse, the bridge goes somewhere new, and then we go back to the A section. Okay. The other thing about it as well, I'll just play this little end bit again.
For you,
back a bit more. Now, in lots of jazz records, we have a 2-5 at the end of the section, which is often the kind of hook of the song. So it should go, Amos Behaving, saving my love for you. 2-5-1. Lots of jazz songs do that. The main hook goes over the 2-5-1. But in the first A section of a jazz song, often there's something called an interrupted cadence, where before we get the one, land there back on our home chord, there's a little interruption where we go via some other chords, and it's called a 3-6-2-5. So we go, Amos Behaving, saving my love for you. Oop, hang on, saving my love for you. And we have another little four chord pattern which delays the one kind of chord coming back around. He goes, for you, for you, for you, for you, as a way of stretching out the hook almost. We go into our second kind of verse here. Let's have a little listen.
I know for certain.
There's a bit when you watch this, just watch what the drummer, the singleton's doing there. You might not see it on my screen, but you will on your own. And he's just, typical of sweet jazz, he's just stroking the drums, using the brush to get a kind of texture more than out else. And you'll hear the band, they're just kind of plodding away, the bass and guitar, just plodding away on that kind of crotchet beat, two beats on each chord, nothing too kind of fancy just yet.
The one I love, I'm through with flirting, it's you that I'm thinking of.
Just as you hear the clarinet coming in, we have something called a pivot chord, okay? We've been on these chords. There's a chord there, in this case we're in the key V-flat, and we go to a G7th, and it acts like a kind of pivot. It's saying, hang on a second, we're going somewhere new. We're going off in a new kind of harmonic direction. And after that G7th chord there, we land eventually on the minor for the bridge section. Quite common in a jazz standard like this, A-A-B-A structure, the bridge either goes into a minor key when we've been in a major, or if it's the other way around, we've been in a minor key, we go into a major key. And we've now moved tonally from that sort of sound. We've pivoted, and now we're in C minor for the bridge. Typical of jazz arrangements, we've had the trombone playing in the background throughout the verses, providing a nice counterpoint to Fats Waller's voice, similar tone, like a baritone-y sort of sound, quite a bassy sound. And just as we go into the bridge, a clarinet now takes over the kind of counterpoint, which is a much higher instrument. Might be because in this movie version, there's a female character comes in, and the clarinet has a kind of more female quality, perhaps. But you'll hear that as we go through some new changes now over the minor bridge section.
Like Jack Horner in the corner, don't go nowhere, what do I care? You're
I remember this isn't like a music video made for MTV. The only way people like Fats Waller could get on the screen was if they were featured in a movie. And this is a film called Stormy Weather with a plot that has nothing necessarily to do with the song, but he's got his little kind of 3-minute slot, which enhances his career, and he gets paid quite a lot of money for it. So ignore a little bit of the drama that's going on in the background. There's some silly dancing in a minute as well. So we've just finished the bridge section there. We've resolved back. We're on the five chord, a B flat chord to take us back in the last verse. So we've gone from the B section into the final A section, and the song seems to finish. Or does it? Have a listen.
Don't stay out.
Well,
thank you. No place to go. I'm home about it. Just me and my radio.
This moment, we've had 32 bars. That's our song, a 32 bar structure, A, B, A, okay? But like I said, this has been like recorded and written in a kind of sweet jazz style. At this point in the movie, in the performance, we go back to the hot jazz style that you would have heard more in New Orleans or in Harlem, where Fats Waller grew up in New York. So it's going to get hot style now, okay? So a couple of things are going to happen. The tempo is going to double, we're in double time, and we've got some improvisation here where the drummer, Sooty Singleton, who's a fairly famous New Orleans drummer, he's going off on one on the drum kit. Let's have a listen to what he's doing and watch what he's doing on the video. Familiar, we've talked about this before, that use of the tom drum style and the kick drum playing, kind of every beat the bar creates what was called a jungle drum rhythm. That was something that had been featured originally at the Cotton Club in New York by Duke Ellington's drummer Sonny Greer, with this idea of this African toned up-tempo kind of drum rhythm. It's counterplayed against things on kind of the cowbells and the wooden kind of blocks of his drum kit, and that tended to be called like a shimmy rhythm. So he's alternating between those two parts of the kit to show off his improvisational style. And there's a little bit of call and response with Fats Waller's piano riffery that is going on there as well. But I'll play it back and just have another little moment. So this thing to look out for is also Fats Waller's eyebrows at this point. There's a little point when he hears the drum, his eyebrows make some strange kind of action, and he's like, hey, we're going into the hot style. I like it. Watch it and enjoy. Double the tempo now. Eyebrows. And if you watch Fats Waller's hands at this point, this is where he was a brilliant piano player, and he's going into what's called the stride style, in that his left hand's going bass chord, bass chord, bass chord, bass chord, all the way through at the high tempo. Each of those chords is going to be different as well. Technically, that takes quite a kind of, that's quite a good technique. And then his right hand's doing the more fancy riffery going on there. So that is kind of quite an advanced jazz style piano that you're hearing. You'll hear a bit more of it in the solo as well, I think. See the kick drum playing the kind of beat all the way through there. That's a famous dancer who was called Mr. Bojangles. There's even a song about him, and he features in this movie. And then the rest of the band kick in a New Orleans style, in that all the brass instruments are sort of overlapping a little bit and find their own kind of riffs going on, and it gets much more exciting and dynamic.
Saving my
this, as we go back to the verse for one final time, this is where Fats Waller's improvising vocally around the melody. It's not just that simple diatonic melody. You can hear some tasty kind of blue notes that are being kind of phrased by him over it. Just one listen to the final part again. And there's some kind of nice, sophisticated lyrical songwriting going on there. I don't know if you've noticed, but all the verses feature this thing called an internal rhyme. He's saying, I don't stay out late, got no place to go, home about 8, just me and my radio. We don't need that late, near rhyme there. It's just another little clever thing showing the sophistication of the song. And it just adds to the kind of picture as well. So the idea that he's home at 8 o'clock at night because he's got no place to go. You know, we can perhaps empathise with the sentiments of this song in that we can't get out and about and misbehave the way we perhaps used to whilst we're in lockdown. So I've been listening to this song quite a lot. So there's a kind of an introduction to our second year work. I'm going to be doing an example a bit like this with one of our reggae songs and one of our funk songs. But all you've got to do is write up the misbehaving section, and it doesn't need to mention everything that I've spoken about here. Just like in class, you know, we don't put everything into the kind of words that that we talk about and listen. You choose whichever of those techniques you think are best to write about to typify your understanding of jazz music. And I'll see you again soon. Cheers.